Shoot us collectively, just like that sign, our common future. I'm all for our common future, and I think we got to work together to do that. And Syracuse, good place to start. And why not? We've been together for a long time. And we're going to have to do it that way. We're going to have to work together. Good place to start, I think. Good issue, Onondaga Lake. What better place to start right there? It's a symbol. Onondaga Lake is a symbol for environment. Speaking of that, the Tilburg Conference, the one that I've been working with over there lately, have chosen Nanook, the white bear, as a symbol. And the Greenlanders have told us that they don't think he has 20 more years and there will not be any more Nanook. An icon like that we're going to see disappear. Who would have ever thought? All the hunters are complaining in Greenland. They want to go out on the ice. Dogs don't want to go out on the ice. And then there is no ice. Yeah, we're in a flux here. So we have to learn more about that. And we have to do something very positive about it. And I think we have to put our collective minds together, and we have to reorder our priorities here. We have to reorder our priorities. What's needed? I think this idea of point of no return, yeah, I think it's there. I think there's a point of no return. I don't think we're there yet, but we're pushing it. And every day that we don't do something, day closer. Irretrievable day. Irretrievable. And the point of no return, we'll pass it one day if we allow it to happen, and it'll be just like another day. You'll never know, except from there on, downhill. Unless we do something. Okay. Let's figure it out. Let's figure it out. See what we're going to do. I think the first thing to do, make sure you see Al Gore when he gets here on the 14th. I think it's a number one issue. Everybody's got to go see. Now, I don't know whether he's speaking or his film. Is it? Either way, though, you know, help comes in a lot of ways. Al has been traveling all over the world giving his lectures, you know, to 400 or 500 people. And he was told by a very wealthy man, he said, you know, you got to do better than that. He said, you're wasting your energy. It's got to get out faster. So here's some money, make a movie. See? And he did, just like that. And advance the whole thing like that. And from what I understand, what he said, if I heard it correctly, was his movie is now the third most successful movie in the world. And that's good news. That what that means is getting out there. The word is getting out there, and people want to know, and they want to understand it. So I urge you to go see, because I tell you, the ice is melting. Starts a little rivulet. I was standing right there where this little rivulet goes down the ice. And then down below, not even 2.5 hour drive down. It's a river. Torrent. They said every month it gets higher. Every month it gets wider. And last year it flowed the whole year. So, things are happening. while we fuss about $3 a gallon, we have to get a little perspective here. There's a lot of things can be done. And one good thing about his film is he tells you a lot of things that can be done, you know, and it's quite practical, and I think we can do a lot better. But the first thing is educate ourselves. We must know. Everybody's got to know, every individual, everybody that's here has to know. And then get on in, good fight. This is a good fight, you know. It's always good to be on the right side, and I think we're on the right side. So we just take it on, and a lot of people around the world are thinking the same thing. So it's too bad that I can't download all those pictures I took of Greenland. But maybe sometime later we can do that. And you'll see. You'll see the beauty, you'll see the power, you'll see what real authority is. I mean, grind mountains into dust. It's amazing strength. Doctrine of Discovery, well, we have to get the Roman Catholic Church to rescind that. Now, that shouldn't be too hard. Well, another good fight, right? But I think it has to be done because it's a root. And if you don't get the root, the tree keeps growing. 1493, built a nation on that. What do you think of that? Not only that, but the whole world. So that has to be attended to. We can do that. We had them at the meeting in last spring, American Indian Law Alliance. It's kind of like a busy arm of ours in the local area of the United Nations. And we had them. They came. They sent a representative, and before the questions could be asked, he was gone like a shot. He left. He ran, literally ran. So, I think it can be accomplished. It's just another arena, international arena. Most people are outraged. They're outraged by that. They say that's not right. It's one of the few issues that I'm able to talk to somebody about where they get it right away. Because usually Indian issues are so complex, people just get a headache trying to figure it out. But this one, people say, hey, that's not right. And it isn't. So, Doctrine of Discovery. And then moving on with the now the Declaration for the Rights of the World's Indigenous People. Next step to that is making it a declaration, making it into a treaty or convention. If it becomes a treaty and a convention, then it has legal teeth. So little by little, we're bringing the issues. But it's a race. So I think after 18 hours of flight time here, I'm about ready to take some questions or discussions or statements or whatever you're thinking. Feel free.
Welcome home.
Thank you.
I was wondering how you see the perception of the land rights action in the community at large in Central New York. What's the What's the reaction? You told about the black man who welcomed you home, but what's the general drift, do you think?
Well, you know, the land rights, the question I think it's to be tested yet. You know, I haven't heard anything bad. Joe? Nothing bad yet? Okay. So we're still in the game. But I think what happens here is that there has to be a public discussion on this, and somehow or other you hear the voice of the people questioning the direction, and I guess we have to be more proactive in getting you information and in the areas of discussion. But yes, I think public discussion is very much in need, and I think that will determine a lot, because the judges listen. They hear what's going on. Mm-hmm. So we should clarify that. Okay?
Yep. I'm Peter Swords, and I always have a question related to nuclear energy, it seems like. When you mentioned the concerns about global warming and the running out of oil, it seems like many people are going to, you know, sort of make that jump from running out of oil to wanting to get another source of supply, like nuclear energy. And it seems like a very simple, quick jump to go nuclear. I wonder if you could enlighten us a little bit. What have you heard from the indigenous people all over the world? What has been the experience of indigenous people about the way that their land has been taken for nuclear?
The old story always, of course, is that indigenous land has always been taken for whatever use and so forth. Still goes on, but I think everybody, depending on where you are, is so far away from the North Cap, the ice cap, that there's not a relation. You know, people don't say, well, the ice is melting up there, so what? You know, how does it bother here? But obviously, this is a systemic change, and change up there changes over here. So one of our efforts now is to clarify to different sections of the world how the ice melting affects them. You know, how it changes weather, how it brings droughts and extremes in both wind and fires, desertification. The other thing too to be aware of is that in 1950, I was 20 years old and just trying to stay out of jail, basically. There were 2.5 billion people in the world. That's 56 years ago. Today, there's 6.4, maybe 6.5 billion people in the world. So it took 4.5 million years to get to 2.5 billion, and it took 55 years to double that. You all aware of that? That's not sustainable. It's not sustainable. Because every one of those mouths have to be fed, every one of those mouths need water and a place to go and shelter. So, yeah, we have this event. And I think a lot of the people, indigenous people, wherever they are in such basic struggle that they haven't got time to contemplate the big areas are the big question. They're just fighting for survival. It's like a woman going after wood, you know, has to walk all day to get enough wood to come back to make a little fire. And then got to walk another day to get water. Yeah, life is hard. Life is hard. We don't know really how really hard life is. We're pretty, even our poor people would be called rich in other countries. Even our poor people. Poor people got televisions. Some people are eating grass, bark, trying to live. That's quite a inequity out there. So I would say that it's survival for indigenous people almost anywhere, and they're busy with that.
Thank you, Chief Lyons. I've been interested in this question. It may seem a little dull, but do you, in talking about land, to me it depends on people. You have to have people to protect your land. Do you know about the approximate population of the Onondaga Nation now?
Right now? Well, we don't like to talk about population because when you talk numbers, they count men. That's a military question. How many people do you have? As soon as you ask how many people you have, they count men. In other words, how many men do you have? How many fighters do you have? So we rarely say how many. But I say not that many. No, there's not a lot of us. I think a total of the Six Nations, maybe I think we're around 70,000, with Mohawks by far being the most numerous. They're almost half, I would say. And Onondaga being one of the smaller ones, along with Cayuga, Tuscarora.
I'm really excited about the progress in the United Nations on the Declaration, and I'm wondering, yes, and I'm wondering if you're involved at all in the negotiations in the Organization of American States, because I understand there's a declaration also being negotiated there. And then aside from that, I understand that the US government and the Canadian government are using their models of like Native American, Indigenous relations and the way the countries are structured to teach countries in Latin America to run their indigenous relations that way. And I'm just wondering if you think this is a good model to project to as we, I'm just wondering if you can comment on that.
Yeah, we negotiate. I haven't been out of there mostly. Darwin down here has been spending a lot of time at the UN, and we have different people, and I've been ranging a little bit further, but obviously I'm gonna have to get over there. Yeah, negotiation does go on, and it goes on pretty directly. We're pretty heated, and when you're in the international field, you can talk directly to the countries. When you're over here, you can't even get through the front door. But over in the international field, you're right on the same level. So it offers you that opportunity. And our people are getting pretty good negotiators. You know, we're getting better and better. So I understand there were 44 Indian people going to Syracuse University this fall. So out of that, we should get some negotiators. On the other thing, yes, on the issue of democracy, I think that the genius of the Haudenosaunee was the fact that the women choose leadership. I think that really is fundamental. It's a balance, you know. I mean, it's a matrilineal system. It's not a matriarchal system. So there's a balance with everything, and I think that's what it is, anyway. You know, I mean, if people just living off by themselves, they adjudicate the work. You know, everybody has to pull together, and know how to do that. And the democracy side of it, it's important to have the female voice. Bring a balance to what's going on. So I think also, yeah, I think you have to be more proactive in that area and promote democracy. You know, I think that's a good idea. I mean, that was our idea long ago. And in 1987, the Congress and the Senate passed S-76, which is the recognition of the contribution of democracy to the Constitution of the United States. So they know, and that wasn't easy to do, but we did that. So yeah, I think the idea of democracy is okay, but you know, got to do things first at home. And democracy doesn't come at the end of a gun. That's for sure.
Just very quickly, thank you for your service. But can you tell us if you will publish the letter that you wrote to the Pope about the Doctrine of Discovery?
Oh yeah, yeah. We got to do better with that one. It's a pretty good letter, I think. And the letter has been received by the Pope, so it's in use. You know, we haven't got an official acknowledgement there, but we know it went right into his hands. So yes, we got to get that letter out and make it more available. And you know, in asking for your help, we have to help you, so you know what direction to go with. But yeah, we got to get more proactive in that.
Once again, thank you so much for speaking to us, especially after your long flight.
Yeah.
Two things. One, the Al Gore movie, like you say, is just so wonderful. And he is sold out at the Landmark on Thursday night. But the video is going to be available for free showings at a lot of different churches and other civic organizations the first week in October. I'm sure if people watch the newspaper, there'll be, you know, news of where you can see it. Our church in Central Square has it. I know May Memorial in Syracuse will have that. And then the idea is that after people see it there, to buy their own copies that will be coming out at the stores in mid-October, so that all of us can spread the word that you're speaking
of
tonight.
That's great. Good news. Thank you.
So this is my last thing. As far as getting the word out about the Doctrine of Discovery, the Pope's big mistake, and just tell all the people you can, is that what you say? You would advise us to get the truth out?
Yeah.
Write letters to the editor?
Well, I think there's been a great series. You know, I mean, the whole series has been very informative, and I understand that it's available as well. Each section is available.
Yes.
So I haven't been to every one, so now I know I can get them. So
very good. Thank you.
I have a big one for you. In America, most people are hardwired to try to get the most for themselves and for their families. I want to know, in your opinion, how do you think we need to convince them to use less?
Yeah, I mean, what you say is just really fundamentally what has to be done. There's a lot of ways. I mean, one of the things that I like about Gore's movies, he gives you some instruction at the end. And all the young people in schools and have the opportunity to figure out just how to do that. You know, I mean, everything is there available. So we're looking in your direction too for some ideas. And you'd be surprised. You may not think it's a good idea, but it may be the one everybody's looking for. So, in that direction, there's a lot of work being done. I know that I've been asked to go to Dubai in December, and they're meeting 750 students from around the world who have been working on exactly what you're saying, on how best to conserve, how best to meet these issues. So that, yeah, it's happening, and think up a good one.
Thank you.